Debi, Vinnedge, the Children of God for Life.
Thank you all for being here. Grazie. No capisci italiano? No.
Grazie a tutti per essere qui, non parli italiano.
Today I'm talking to you about these vaccines that have been produced using aborted fetal material, and I call this Vaccines from Abortion, Letting Just a Little Evil In. Because as we go through this, you will see what happens, the consequences when we do that, when we let a little evil in, just like Adam and Eve did. You shall become like gods, from Genesis. This was the temptation of the devil to Adam and Eve. So this is going to take us back to the year 1909, over 100 years ago. There was a man by the name of Harry Lachlan. He was appointed director of the Master Race Project. Under this Master Race Project, the intent was to sterilize all people who they deemed to be unfit, unfit to breed, unwed mothers, homeless people, mentally handicapped. He was founder of a eugenics center in Cold Springs Harbor, New York, where a number of these sterilizations were being performed. And his law that he had put in, this trying to get involved in this Sterilization Act, actually in the United States there was a Model Sterilization Act. The model sterilization was actually used worldwide, and Adolf Hitler himself modeled his own sterilization and tortures of the Jews after his legislation. And for that, he received an honorary doctorate at Heidelberg University. The next person I'm going to introduce you to is someone named Foster Kennedy. He was so extreme in his laws of sterilization and trying to weed out the imperfect. He thought it was okay to kill imperfect babies up to 5 years of age to relieve the agony of the defective. The next person is a woman by the name of Helen McMurtrie, and she was elected in 1915 as Inspector of the Feeble-Minded. She persuaded the Canadian government that the eugenics was the answer to preventing degenerate babies, and her idea was that we should segregate and sterilize. The next person here, in 1928, the Human Betterment Foundation was founded in Pasadena, California, in the United States, by Clarence Gamble of Procter & Gamble. Over 7,600 women were sterilized. These were women considered unfit to breed. I should explain, when these women that were being sterilized, what they were doing is they were considered unfit if they were unwed mothers. Harry Lachlan was also a consultant to the Human Betterment Foundation that in the end donated billions of dollars to Planned Parenthood. Of course, we know who Margaret Sanger is. She is a notorious eugenicist and founder of Planned Parenthood. And she's famous for these words, "The most merciful thing that a family does to one of its infant members is to kill it." What does this have to do with vaccines? In early 1900s, there was a polio pandemic in Europe, North America, Australia, New Zealand. Over 27,000 cases of polio were reported in Boston and New York area, and so became what we call a race for the cure. As I was doing research, I read this document that was put out. This is by Albert Sabin from Experimental Biology in 1936. He said, "A new approach was made by the use of 3 to 4 month old human embryos obtained by abdominal hysterotomy for therapeutic indications." I had never heard of abdominal hysterotomy. I did not know what this was, and so I looked it up. And I read in the Journal of Obstetrics and Gynecology that abdominal hysterotomy is only done in rare situations, very rare, especially in early termination of pregnancy, unless there was some type of a problem where sterilization would be required also, or if the person had mental disease. These sterilizations were being, the abortions were being done, at the Bellevue Hospital, where the head of neurology was none other than Foster Kennedy. So we have sterilizations going on right next door at Cold Springs Harbor in New York and abortions being done at Bellevue with Harry Lachlan involved. The next article I read is from Dr. Enders Wells Robbins of the Journal of Immunology in 1949, and he wrote, embryos of 12 to 18 weeks, again, obtained by abdominal hysterotomy, and he said rarely tissues were obtained from stillborn fetuses or from premature infants, and they were using the skin and connective and intestinal muscle and brain tissue. The abortions there were being done at the Boston Lying-In Hospital, Women's Hospital, where the sterilizations were also performed. The next came from Drs. Thick, Duncan, Franklin, and Rhodes. This broke my heart. From the Canadian Journal of Science, 1952, human embryos of 2 to 5 months were obtained from the gynecological department of Toronto General Hospital. In many of the embryos, the heart was still beating at the time of receipt in the virus laboratory. Toronto General Hospital, yes, where Helen McMurtry did her internship. This was polio vaccine research, forced sterilizations, and forced abortions of these women. Had no say in it. Moving on to 1959 to 1964, there's a man by the name of Dr. Hilary Kaprowski. And he worked for Karolinska Institute before taking a job at Wistar Institute, which is the research for the University of Philadelphia in Pennsylvania. Under him was Dr. Leonard Hayflick, who also worked for Wistar. And Dr. Kaprowski wanted to test his polio vaccine that he was developing using human tissue. So Dr. Hayflick obliged him by creating what was known as WISH, a cell line called WISH. It stands for Wistar Institute, Susan Hayflick. And this tissue sample came from his own daughter, placenta, a newborn baby. Nothing wrong with that. However, there was a problem. He needed more tissue to continue testing to see if he could get this to work. And so he went back to Dr. Kaprowski, who called on his old friends from Karolinska Institute, Dr. Svengard and Dr. Erling Norby. And these two doctors began shipping aborted babies from Sweden to the United States. And Dr. Erling Norby wrote, quote, one of my duties as a young student in the lab in Stockholm was to dissect human fetuses from legal abortions and send the organs to the Wistar Institute. Such material was the source of Leonard Hayflick's study of WI-38 cells. And I'll be talking more about WI-38 in another slide. The next person I want to bring in to introduce you to is the serial cultivation of these cell lines, what was actually happening. Leonard Hayflick wrote in his journal, The Serial Cultivation of Human Diploid Cell Strains, from 1961 to 1964. And he listed the cell lines WI1 and WI2 all the way through WI, and that for first one it was through WI26, and more information turned up later. But what he was doing was there were multiple organs taken from, say, for example, in some of the aborted babies, they would take maybe the lungs and the brain tissue, and he numbered them WI1, WI2, so forth. So they wrote about how there were two groups of human fetuses that were aged 8 to 20 weeks that were used in the initiation of these cell strains. The first group was normal embryos obtained, again, by hysterotomy, abdominal hysterotomy, and they were flown in from Sweden. There were 32 recorded elective abortions, with multiple samples being taken from lung, skin, muscle, kidney, heart, thyroid, thymus. Okay, the next person I'm going to introduce you to here is a man by the name of Stanley Plotkin. And he became involved because in 1964 there was a rubella epidemic in the United States. Actually, it was worldwide. And doctors in Philadelphia began advising pregnant women to abort their babies. The reason for aborting is that if a woman contracts rubella in her first trimester of pregnancy, there's about a 20% chance her baby will be born with some form of congenital rubella syndrome. That might be a rash, or it could be something serious, deafness, blindness, mental impairment. So what would result was something known as RA273. If you looked today for that information, you would find it is the virus being used for rubella vaccine. The R stands for rubella, A stands for abortion, 27 is the 27th baby that was aborted, and 3 is the third tissue taken from that baby where they found the rubella virus. Later, there was another article that was written. After they already had RA273, they continued to do this aborted fetal research. And Dr. Plotkin talked about 40 rubella fetuses that were cultured, and cell strains they were able to get out of 34 of them. If you do the numbers, we have 67 abortions for the virus and another 32 in order to create this cell line WI38. So we know how many people were told there were only 2 abortions? Mm-hmm. That's right. We know at least 99, at least, that I found in my recordings of their research. And that's just for one vaccine. In January 2018, Stanley Plotkin was being interviewed in court. There was a lawsuit that had been brought. And he tried to tell the attorney, he used how many fetuses? And he said, 2. And the attorney said, why does it say 76 in this paper that you wrote? And he had to admit he used 76 fetuses himself. Stanley Plotkin also admitted in court that he was an atheist and that he figured he'd probably go to hell for what he'd done. He wrote that in his paper, he wrote, it is better to experiment on handicapped children, this was for testing the vaccine, who are less likely to be able to contribute to society. Okay, so aborted fetal research continues here. Into 1966, we have MRC5. This is something you all here in Europe would be very familiar with this cell line. It's in your vaccines from a 14-week gestation male baby. The cell line itself was developed specifically because there was patent rights issue over money with WI38. And it was lung tissue that they used, and the reason for the abortion was psychiatric reasons. Now, I asked, when I had a priest visiting our parish from London, and I asked him what that meant, and he said, it's one of those abortion exceptions, because abortion wasn't legal in the United Kingdom at that time, unless there was mental problems, health of the mother. The next cell line we talk about in 1972 is called HEK293. Alex van der Ebbed from the Netherlands reported on this. Now, HEK stands for human embryonic kidney. It is the 293rd specimen. They said the cells were obtained from a single, apparently healthy, legally aborted fetus under Dutch law. Identity of the parents and reason for the abortion were unknown. Next woman to introduce you to here is Christine Beiswanger from Coriel Cell Repository. She reported on the abortions that were being done using minced lung tissue. The first one was they named IMR-90, IMR-90 from a 4-month female and IMR-91 from a 12-week male. What they were doing was trying to mimic the existing cell lines of WI38 and MRC5. So they designed these cells for that reason. So you might ask, why? Why did they do this? Leonard Hayflick, in his work with the aborted babies and the cell lines, established what's known as the law of cell senescence. All normal cells, whether they're animal or human, have a finite lifespan. They are not immortal. The lifespan of those cell lines are directly proportionate to the age of the donor. So if you use one from a fetal stage, it's going to live a lot longer than a middle-aged or an adult elderly person. He found that eventually the cell lines would become unstable and cancerous tumors would form. Okay, moving 1980, we have another new cell line here, more abortions being done. By the way, every cell line I talk about here is being used today in vaccines or medicines. This is Dr. Stephen Aaron Liebheiber from Howard Hughes Medical Institute. And he developed what is known as lambda HE1, which is liver tissue. This is liver tissue. Yes, did you say liver tissue? Okay, sorry. The next person here is, again, we've got Dr. Van der Ebb coming up again with a new cell line, PERC6, which is retinal tissue from an 18-week gestation baby in the FDA hearings in 2001. I'm quoting from him, he said, "So I isolated retina from a healthy fetus of 18 weeks old. The woman wanted to get rid of the fetus. The father was unknown. PERC6 was made just for pharmaceutical manufacturing of adenovirus vectors." And then he said, "I realize this sounds a bit commercial, but PERC6 were made for that reason." Now, in 2015, we reported this as a new, brand new aborted fetal cell line had emerged for vaccine production. And then we introduced you to Walvax2, which these abortions were performed in China under the one-child policy and forced abortion. This baby was chosen from 9 different abortions, and what they were doing, they wanted, again, to mimic these cell lines. This is a 3-month gestation female baby lung tissue. They were following, again, specific guidelines to mimic those cell lines, WI-38 and MRC-5. The reason being why they did this in China is their supply of WI-38 and MRC-5 no longer was working. They would have had to order new through the United States. In the paper, they note how these abortion was done using what's called a water bag abortion. I'd never heard of a water bag abortion before. Neither had my gynecologist friends. What they did is actually they used a water bag that would be placed at the lower part of the cervix, and they did a mechanical type pressuring that would cause the woman to go into labor, an induced labor. They did this because they wanted to make sure that they had live, intact organs. It is absolutely critical that they have live tissue and intact organs. What they were doing is they were very careful to make sure they were looking for the right gestation age, the right samples of tissue. The abortions were all pre-planned. We know that they changed the timing of the abortion to fit their gestation age, and the method of abortion was also changed to be sure that the baby would be born live and then dissected. So just so you don't have to take my word, you don't have to take my word for this. Meet the whistleblowers who report. Dr. Gonzalo Herranz, professor of embryology at University of Navarra, Spain, wrote, "The correct way is to use cesarean section of removal of the uterus, then to obtain embryo cells for culture. A programmed abortion must be adopted, choosing the age of the embryo and dissecting it while still alive to remove tissues to be placed in culture media." The next person is Dr. Bernard Nathanson. He, by the way, was a famous abortionist at one time who actually became Catholic. He converted. He changed his ways when he saw alsanogram. This is what happened. But he wrote about how the abortions were being done with vaccines from Dr. Peter McCullough's book, who was witnessing these abortions in Sweden. 16 to 21 weeks, they would do prostaglandin abortions, where a chemical is injected into the womb, causing the woman to go into mini labor and pass the baby. 50% of the time, the baby would be born alive, but that didn't stop them. They would simply open up the abdomen of the baby with no anesthesia and take out the organs. The last one here, Dr. Ian Donald, personally witnessed the abortions that were being done at the Karolinska Institute for the Vaccine Research. He said experiments were being performed on near-term alive aborted babies who were not even afforded the mercy of anesthetic as they writhed and cried in agony. And when their usefulness had expired, they were executed and discarded as garbage. Now, I'm going to go over how these vaccines were being developed, okay? In step one, in this picture, you see the 3-month gestation baby's lung tissue is being extracted. From that, they are going to culture the cells from the lung tissue. This is showing a petri dish. The cells multiply in the labs. I think they do it in a different way now. The cells are then placed in deep freeze and frozen for future uses as well. The next step, I'm going to show you the difference between the United States and Japan, going right back to that rubella epidemic. In the United States, we start with the virus. We use the RA273 strain. In Japan, they used what is known as the Takahashi strain and the Matsura strain. In the United States, ours, of course, was the 27th rubella baby aborted, but in Japan, they swabbed the throat of an infected child. The next step in the United States, we grew the RA273 on a cell line, okay, in the United States, and so did Japan. Okay. In the United States, we used WI38 and MRC5, and mostly in Europe, from the Karolinska Institute. Europe went more toward the MRC5. In Japan, they used the kidney of a rabbit and quail eggs. The U.S. rubella strain, by the way, is used worldwide. But there was absolutely no reason to use aborted babies. None. My Italiano. These cell lines you would find in the package insert that comes with a vaccine at the doctor's or in the patent itself. And it's in the description under cellular DNA components and the billion-dollar question we know they don't have to is why are we using aborted fetal material at all? The very first thing, of course, is that in their research, they noted that it was economical and plentiful. The next reason, of course, well, we've had government funding since 1993. Under President Clinton, the pharmaceutical industry lobbied for federal funding. Okay? Once you have that, now these universities are all applying for grants. They can do sales. They establish patents. It's a billion-dollar industry. Final reason here is to protect abortion rights. I tell you a story. In October of 2000, the state of Arizona in the United States was trying to legalize aborted fetal research. And the judge ruled that they had to allow aborted fetal research because it might interfere with a woman's right to choose. If she couldn't donate her baby for research, she might not have an abortion. Okay. So in this one video, the woman, the abortionist, said, I'm going to basically crush below, I'm going to crush above, and I'm going to see if I can get it all intact. This was for the sale of aborted fetal parts. This is Planned Parenthood, was on Fox News. Jess McIntosh said, this exact kind of tissue donation was used to make the rabies, chickenpox, and polio vaccines. This is life-saving medical research. In addition, there was an AP, Associated Press report from Planned Parenthood videos. Dr. Paul Offit, who is at the CHOP, it's called, it's the Children's Hospitals of Pennsylvania, said, rubella caused 5,000 spontaneous abortions a year, every year, prior to the vaccine. We wouldn't have saved all those lives had it not been for those fetal cells. So we just did a fact check and looked up the real truth. First of all, the first rubella vaccine was licensed in 1969, and it used canine cells, duck cells, and rabbit cells. The aborted fetal version of rubella wasn't even licensed in the United States until 1979. When you looked at the records, there was actually a total, over these 10 years, a total of 1,064 confirmed cases of congenital rubella syndrome. From those cases of congenital rubella syndrome, the actual spontaneous abortions declined from 69 cases in 1970 to 22 in 1976, and no confirmed data from 77 to 79. Obviously, aborted fetal cells had absolutely nothing to do with the decline of spontaneous abortion. In New York, you may have heard of this in the news recently. We have a new abortion law in New York that allows termination of the baby through your due date, up through the due date. This is where they reported, and the person that was making the Gosnell film for under this undercover exposure said, aborted baby bodies are a very valuable commodity in research. For institutions, universities, medical centers, they pay a lot of money. And he said, I'm in complete shock saying on television in America in 2019 that you can buy the arms and legs of babies. We've had some reports of measles outbreaks in the United States, but this has been a big push lately in the United States for vaccinations in 2015 and also again in 2018 to 19. And I say, blame Merck, not the parents. Until 2009, parents could buy legal, could obtain morally produced separate measles and mumps vaccines, and they could abstain in conscience under laws in New York, in the United States for religious reasons, and so that's what they would do. Parents were buying the separate doses. Yeah, and rubella has been eliminated in the United States for many, many years. Since there's less than 10 cases every year since before 2005, and none of those were native cases. None came from the United States. Okay, so when Merck stopped making these, we went out to the public and said, "Let's demand. We want these vaccines back." And we wrote to Merck as well. They told me that it was not financially feasible for them to keep doing. They weren't making any money, but financials showed they made over $10 million. So when that didn't work, we went to ask them, would they allow outsourcing of that vaccine to another company, like maybe Dr. Deicher? And Merck said, their response was, in discussing this within Merck, we have concluded we would have no desire to outlicense our malevolent technology. We need, I cannot say this enough, we need our Catholic leaders to unite worldwide. As long as we keep taking the status quo, we're accepting these vaccines, there's never going to be a change. If there's no demand for moral doses, they'll never, ever change. We have to do some good news. We have the Catholic Medical Association in the United States. Recently, there was an article out last year about humanizing mice. So what they were doing is they're building on it, they're trying to mimic the human immune system, and they were doing late-term aborted fetal organs to basically clone these mice to make a humanized immune system. I know Dr. Burke, or Cardinal Burke, will recognize these two people who are going to be introduced here. Dr. Stephen White with the Catholic Medical Association said, the FDA says the research using aborted babies is critical to understanding how the human immune system responds to certain drugs and biologics, helping to better understand diseases that affect millions of Americans. And the CMA, of course, says, we strongly disagree. We oppose sacrificing any human life that justifies this type of human experimentation. The second comment came from Dr. Peter Morrow, Cardinal Burke. Again, he met Dr. Morrow in Orlando in 2014. That's where I met Cardinal Burke, too. The use of unborn human life for experimentation by the United States government is unconscionable. We are calling for an immediate stop to this practice, using the Trump administration to revoke their contracts. Thank you, Catholic Peter Medical Association. Francis Collins from the National Institutes of Health came back in his response and said, there's strong evidence that scientific benefits can come from fetal tissue research. And in response, at 2018 hearing, Science and Truth says, if we stopped harvesting fresh tissue from aborted fetuses, it will not stop one person from being treated or vaccinated, nor will it inhibit the development of new vaccines going forward. After 100 years of research, no therapies require aborted fetal tissue. Nowhere was that more evident than with the release of GlaxoSmithKline has produced a new morally produced shingles vaccine. The proof is completely in the product on this one. Merck said this could never be done, by the way. They said they had to use aborted fetal tissue for the chickenpox virus, for the shingles virus. I love to prove them wrong. Shingrix vaccine was approved by the FDA in 2017. It's produced on Chinese hamster ovary cells. Merck's Zostavax was approved in 2006. It uses both MRC5 and WI38 aborted fetal cells. In Shingrix, they used saponin to elicit an immune response. Saponin comes from the bark of an evergreen tree. Merck used the weakened virus to produce an immune response. So there's a live virus in their vaccine, but not in shingles vaccine. The results are, in Shingrix vaccine has been 97% effective in people over 50 years old, where compared to Merck's, which is 50% effective over 50 years old. Shingrix is 90% effective in people over 70 years old versus Merck at 38% effective. In Shingrix, 95% immunity was maintained over 4 years, 40% with Merck. Fact has been proven. Aborted fetal material is never scientifically or medically necessary. Now, this is a wonderful thing that has happened. I wanted to tell you what we did in the United States, just briefly. In last year, when the new shingles vaccine came out, we went to had a meeting with the U.S. Conference of Bishops office, pro-life office, and with the Catholic Medical Association and the National Catholic Bioethics Center. As a result of that meeting, we decided to do a pressure campaign and asked, first of all, that all of our dioceses in the United States would no longer purchase Merck's vaccine whatsoever. There was no reason to. There's a moral option. This was easy. And the bishops did exactly that, and they responded and thanked GlaxoSmithKline and asked them to start producing moral options for other vaccines. Results are in. Merck's sale of Zostavax through the third quarter is all they had for 2018. We're getting to see third quarter results. Their sales were $163 million. Sounds like a lot. Compared to 2017, same time frame, $547 million. It's a 70% loss. This is great action. We've got a lot of longer to go on that, but so. This is a very important slide. I'm going to talk about the myths that are out there, the things that we keep hearing over and over again about these vaccines. First myth, the abortions were not done with the intention of creating vaccines. False. From what you've seen today in the document by the researchers themselves, we know that their direct involvement. Myth number two, descendant cells are not part of the original aborted fetus. Just read this week. Someone tried to say that the cells are not part of that aborted baby. Absolutely not true. The DNA from that aborted baby is so intact and identical to the first cells that are harvested. Leonard Hayflick actually told me you could theoretically clone that original aborted baby using cloning techniques today. That's how intact. If this DNA was not intact, if there was something wrong with those cells, FDA and the World Health Organization would require safety testing every time they were used. Next myth, that it was only of a couple of abortions from the past. No. We know that hundreds, if not thousands, of abortions were done before they perfected the cell. Myth that no further abortions would be needed now or in the future. We know that's not true since we have new aborted fetal cell lines as early, as 2015, and thousands of new abortions have been done. So this false information that has been put out there to the public, to the doctors, to even our clergy, has led to this acceptance and a tacit approval of using those aborted fetal cells. And worse, parents have been persecuted. And I'm going to stop here for a minute to just say something, because it was because of parental persecution that I met Sabrina. She was living in New York and ran into problems with trying to get a religious exemption for the aborted fetal vaccines in her diocese. It's pretty bad when you have to leave the country.
E ho lasciato un lavoro a Wall Street.
I'm going to tell you how we got started with this. This is the same parental persecution that started with a woman by the name of Shannon Law. And it was a cry for help. Shannon Law was a mom, a mother of three, in the state of Arkansas, required chickenpox vaccine for attendance at school. Okay, so the law in Arkansas stated that your religion had to oppose immunizations, and she didn't know what to do. She went to her priest at the Catholic parish. He didn't know what to do and told her to call the diocese. Well, the diocese told her they didn't know what to do either. So Shannon picked up the phone at 3 o'clock in the morning and called the Vatican. She called the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith. And she spoke to an amazing, she got an English-speaking priest, Monsignor Charles Brown. And he told her he'd never heard of this either. And he said he would look into it and get back. But she knew that she wasn't going to get a fast answer. But time was running out. Her children were facing expulsion. She called Children of God for Life. She called me. So after hearing what she said, it wasn't just confined to her. Many parents had this problem in different places. So I agreed to call the Vatican, and I got up at 3 a.m. to call the congregation. And Monsignor Charles Brown answered the phone again. And when I explained to him that this was happening to parents nationwide, he told me to prepare two packages of information, one for him, and the second would be for Cardinal Ratzinger, who was then prefect for the Congregation of the Doctrine of the Faith. And he said, while we review this, you are to instruct parents. They are to use the church teaching on moral conscience. And if they turn away from their conscience, that would be a grave error. In 24 hours, I had the church teaching on moral conscience on our website and downloaded for Shannon Law in the catechism, in the papal encyclicals. It was there. Meanwhile, her children were expelled from school, and she decided to take it to court and hired a lawyer. The lawyer was a Christian law firm, was not Catholic, and he didn't have any idea about Catholic teaching. So I sent him copies of everything that we had. So they went to court, and the attorney for the state stood up and said, Your Honor, I have a document here from a Catholic bioethicist says it's okay for Catholics to use these vaccines. This is great. So the judge, a lawyer for Shannon Law stood up and said, Your Honor, I don't know what he's got, this article, but I have something called the Catechism of the Catholic Church, signed by Pope John Paul II. It was wonderful. Judge immediately ruled for Shannon Law, immediately. As a result, that unconstitutional law that gave favoritism, you know, said your religion had to oppose immunizations, was judged unconstitutional. As a result, also, Catholic teaching for the first time was upheld in state courts. Well, not maybe the first time, but it was important to uphold that right of conscience that our bishops are fighting for. And as a result, the Vatican would respond 3 years later. The Pontifical Academy for Life wrote to me in June of 2005, and they talked about various levels of cooperation from those who use the cell lines to make the vaccines and those who use them for health. Merck, guilty, direct material cooperation, and complicit with the original act of abortion. For parents and physicians, they said, it is right to abstain from using these vaccines if it can be done without causing children and indirectly the population as a whole to undergo significant risk. It's important, significant risk. However, if the latter are exposed to considerable danger to their health, vaccines could be used on a temporary basis. They said there was a grave responsibility to use alternatives and to make a conscientious objection to those that have moral problems. They said that such cooperation occurs in a context of moral coercion of the conscience, of parents who are forced to choose to act against their conscience or otherwise put the health of their children and the population as a whole at risk. This is an unjust alternative choice which must be eliminated as soon as possible. And so, the gauntlet was dropped. 2 years later, it is December 6th, 2007. My hopes were so full when I got that document. I thought, we're going to get moral vaccines. This is beautiful. The Vatican is saying we need to have them. We're going to stand up. We're going to do things. But I kept hitting brick wall after brick wall. And finally, I was becoming very, very sad. I knelt down in prayer in the quiet church, and I said, Lord, I will do anything you ask of me. I just don't know what you want anymore. And I was praying the St. Andrew Novena, and I said, Lord, I've never put a timeline on you, but if I don't get a sign from you by the end of the year, I'm going to lay down this cross. I said, I don't want to do that. I'll do anything you ask. I just don't know what to do.
Non so che cosa fare.
And I went away crying. 2 days later, it was December 8th, the Feast of the Immaculate Conception. I get a call from this woman I've never heard of before in my life. It's Dr. Teresa Deischer. And in... And she was telling me how she was going to form a new biotech company, and she had heard about my work through a mutual pro-life friend. The name of her company was to be called AVM Biotechnology, which stands for Ave Maria Biotechnology.
Che significa Ave Maria Biotechnology.
I had my sign.
Ha detto ecco il mio segno, la mia risposta.
She also has found, she picked up that gauntlet. By the time we got off the phone, she agreed that she would help us in pursuit of moral vaccines. Dr. Deischer is a hero. She has might become my dear friend, and I am so proud for you to be able to hear her about her work. Thank you so much.